Thank you so much for all the support this channel has received. We just recently reached over 20,000 subscribers, which is really, really cool. So thank you for that. As usual, the video is sponsored by JLCPCB, so thank you to them as well. And lastly, I'd just like to mention before we get started that I'm thinking about, with the help of Robert Faranek, of making a PCB design course. And this would cover topics in far greater detail. We'll look at maybe RF design, mixed signal, PCB layout, PCB design for EMC, and so on. But this would then probably have to be a paid course. So there's a little survey, and I'll leave the link in the description. It would mean a lot to me if you could maybe just fill this out, maybe some suggestions if you'd be interested in something like this. But okay, let's get started with the video. Thanks again. I'd like to show you how to make this really simple two-layer STM32F1 breakout board in KiCad. We'll go through how we connect the STM32 up to USB, the crystals and so forth, and then we'll also order it via JLCPCB. So let's get started. The first thing we need to do is choose the parts. I've chosen this really standard STM32F103 microcontroller. It's really cool because it's actually USB capable, and then we can flash programs via USB, which is really useful, or relay data via USB. We also need a regulator because we're going to be powering this board via USB, so we need to step 5 volts down to 3.3 volts. And we do this with one of these low dropout regulators. It's really cool, it goes up to 200 milliamps, and that's more than sufficient for this application, and it doesn't require large bypass capacitors. So let's move over to KiCad and see what the schematic looks like. So here we are in KiCad. I've made a project which you can also download via my GitHub account, and I'll leave a link in the description below. Essentially, it's three main parts. We have the USB, which also acts as a power source with a 3.3 volt regulator. We have the STM32F1 microcontroller and everything we need to attach to that. And then we finally have GPIO headers, where we break out all the pins which we want to use from the STM32 microcontroller. So let's go through section by section of the schematic. Let's start off with the first section of the schematic, and that's the USB and regulator section. As I said before, the board is powered via USB, so we get 5 volts at the input. Now, the USB power rails are typically pretty noisy, especially if you plug it into something like a laptop. So I'm performing some basic filtering using this ferrite bead and this one capacitor over here, and that forms a form of low-pass filter. This filtered signal, or this filtered voltage, then gets fed into this really simple LDO low-dropout regulator. And this steps our 5 volts down to 3.3 volts over here. This regulator is really nice because it's small enough, and it's stable with 1 microfarad input and output capacitors, so these capacitors can be nice and small. I've also added a green LED plus current limiting resistor R1 to make sure we know when the board is powered up and the 3.3 volt rail is available. You might think that this R1 value is pretty high, but I like to run my LEDs at fairly low currents, maybe 1 or 2 milliamps. You can also see over here, the USB connector also, of course, has data connections, and I've labeled them with USB underscore D plus and USB underscore D minus. Labeling in that way, with a plus and minus, tells KiCad that this is a differential pair, and this will become in really handy later when we start routing this board. Because this board is also a device, you can see I've left the shield floating, and I've added a little comment down here as well. If you have a metallic enclosure of some sort, you would typically then tie the shield to that metallic enclosure. However, this is just a free-hanging breakout board, and as it's a device, we want to leave the shield floating, because typically the USB is tied to ground at the host side. The next part of the schematic is actually to do with the STM32 microcontroller itself, and you can see there's a bit more to it, but we'll go over everything in detail. The first thing I'd recommend you do is download STM32 Cube IDE, which is a free program provided by ST, and that lets you program the devices, but also do the pin assignments. So that's really useful when you're designing your own hardware. You can click on certain pins and see what they maybe are capable of, for example, I2C or SPI in this case. And that's what I'm going to use for this breakout board as well. As you can see, I've already marked a couple of pins and their functions. Essentially, all of the remaining other pins, which I haven't set yet, will just be routing to some external header, and we can configure those pins later. The first important pair of pins are these ones over here, PD0 and PD1. And we'll be connecting an external crystal to this, so we get more precise timing. The next important pins are PA13 and PA14, and these are actually the debug pins, so we can use serial wire debug to interface with this chip, upload firmware, and do debugging. This is really useful. So these are the things I guess you would pretty much always want to include, some sort of external crystal if you require precise timing, and the serial wire debug pins, or JTAG if you prefer. I've also added the USB pins over here, PA11 and PA12, and this is the differential pair. And these are the USB data pins, which will then be hooking up to the USB connector. So let's move back to KiCad. In KiCad, I've imported the symbol for the STM32F103 microcontroller, And you can see basically all the pins are here. We have all the pin banks A, pin banks B, pin banks C, D, and so on. But let's start with the power pins, which are up here, and the ground pins, which are down here. The power pins you can tie to your system voltage, and typically for an STM32 microcontroller, that would be something like 3.3 volts. So that's what I've done up here. What you also need to do is add decoupling capacitors, which I've moved slightly up here. You can, of course, connect them directly to these pins, but I'm doing it via this power flag. And what you want to do for the main power pins is have one bulk decoupling capacitor. That could be something like 4.7 microfarads, or maybe something like 10 microfarads. But then you also want, per VDD pin, one 100 nanofarad capacitor. So I essentially have four here because I have VBAT and three VDDs. And then later in layout and routing, you'd place them as close as possible to the power pins. There's also this VDDA pin over here, which is connected to a slightly different voltage. And that's something to do with this filter network up here. The VDDA pin essentially is the power pin for all the analog sections in the microcontroller, be this the ADC, DAC, and so on. So you might want to perform some additional filtering. And that's what I've done here. So I've taken the 3.3 volt rail, fed it through this L1 inductor into these parallel capacitors, and that forms a low pass filter. And then I get my 3.3 volt effectively analog voltage out, which is slightly filtered. ST recommends typically having two parallel capacitors for the VDDA pin, and I've chosen a larger one, 1 microfarad, and one normal one, 100 nanofarads in parallel. The next interesting section are these pins up here. We have an N reset pin, a boot zero pin, and these PDO PD1 pins. The N reset pin essentially means if you pull this pin low and then high again, you've reset the microcontroller. If this pin is generally high, there will be no reset. Luckily for us, if you go to the STM32 datasheet, you can actually scroll down and see that this pin has an internal pull-up. So we don't need to actually add a pull-up resistor over here. If you want to maybe reset the microcontroller via push button, of course you can add that, and then you just need to pull this pin low and then release it again. We also have this boot zero pin over here, and this is a bit more interesting. This essentially determines if the bootloader will run on the STM32 microcontroller when we start it up. If the boot zero pin is pulled low, we can program the device normally via serial via debug, and the firmware will just run on this device. However, if we pull it high, it'll start in bootloader mode when this chip powers up. And that means you can program it via UART and sometimes USB. So that's really cool. The way I've done it is I typically just pull it down low with a 10K resistor. And if I want to enable the bootloader, I just use this solder jumper over here. And that pulls it to 3.3 volts. The next two pins we saw in STM32 Cube IDE, which were the pins over here, PD0 and PD1. These are the high-speed external crystal in and outs. So we attach, for example, like an 8 MHz, 12 MHz, or something like a 16 MHz crystal to these pins. So it has an input and an output. Now a crystal, I've chosen an 8 MHz one with two pins, but a crystal will always in general require loading capacitors. So you see C10 and C11 over here, with the values of 30 picofarads each. The values of these capacitors depend on the actual crystal you choose, but there's a really way an approximate way of how you can calculate what these values need to be. If you look at the datasheet for this crystal that I've chosen this 8 MHz crystal over here. I go in the datasheet, and even though it's in a different language, you can see that the load capacitance, CL, is 20 picofarads. So you need to find the value of the load capacitance, subtract a stray capacitance, so that's due to the pins and the traces, and that's typically somewhere from 3 to 5 picofarads, and then multiply that result by 2. So we had C load was 20 picofarads, I subtract 5 picofarads, that's 15, and I multiply the result by 2. That means the load capacitors need to be 30 picofarads. And surprise, surprise, C10 and C11 are 30 picofarads. So that's how you calculate that. Go by the datasheet, find the load capacitance, and use this formula. The next thing we need to look at are the USB pins, and they're located on PA11 and PA12. Remember, STM32 Cube IDE is your friend and will tell you what the pinouts are. Now, as I said before, these will then link up to the USB connector, and they're named especially USB underscore D minus and USB underscore D plus to tell KiCad that this is a differential pair. Some STM32 microcontrollers include all the series termination and pull-up resistors on the USB lines. This one does, except for the 1.5 kilo-ohm pull-up that you need on the USB D plus line for this device to be recognized. So I've added it here. You can see I just have a pull-up resistor of 1.5 kilo-ohms pulled up to 3.3 volts. And you can see that in one of the application notes relating to STM32 microcontrollers and USB. Just below the USB connections, you can see I have the serial wire debug pin, the input output, and the clock pin. And again, that's taken from STM32 Cube IDE, PA13 and PA14. I always think it's nice to add an LED that you can toggle via the STM32 microcontroller, and that's exactly what I've done here. So I've added blue LED and again a current limiting resistor to make sure we don't overdrive this GPIO or pull or source too much current from this pin. Finally, you can see I've added all these global labels to these microcontroller pins, and you can see you can do that over here by clicking place global label. So I've done that because if we move to the last section of the schematic, we can see this over here are the GPIO headers. And then essentially all of the remaining pins, which we don't know what we're doing with yet, we just want to use to these breadboard friendly headers. I've included power and ground, the serial wire debug pins, and so on, and all the remaining pins that we might want to use. In an ideal world, you would add between each signal pin, you would add a ground or power pin to make for signal integrity and EMI reasons. But for a really simple board like this, I guess this is fine. You could also add decoupling capacitors at the 3.3 volt terminals of the GPIO headers. Once you're done with the schematic, the next thing you can do is actually give all these components names. So for example, FB1, C1, C2, C3, and so on. The way you do that in KiCad is either double click and then type in the reference, or you can just click on annotate schematic symbols and annotate, and KiCad will do it for you. Once you've done that, you click on this bug icon up here, and that's an ERC, electrical rules check. And then you can click run, and it'll show you if you have any errors or warnings and so on before you proceed with layout. Once you've done that, you can click this button over here, which is assign PCB footprints to schematic symbols. So you've made the schematic, but KiCad still then doesn't know what size of components you would like. So we could choose maybe many different values for the size of components of C3, C4, and so on. And you do that by clicking on this button over here. Once this screen is loaded, you can see here you have the component designators, their values, and then the sort of footprint you would like for them. For power components, I typically choose larger, sizes like 0603, 0805, and something like small decoupling capacitors, you're fine with something like 0402. But make sure what your supplier has in stock. Once we've finished with the component selection and footprint selection, we move over to PCB New and then do the layout and routing by clicking this button. Here we are in PCB New, and this is where you do all the layout and routing of your PCB. As you can see, I've already done it, but I would like to talk you through my choices and why I did the things I did. Now this is a two-layer board, so we have a top layer where we'll have all our signals, and the bottom layer will be a solid ground plane for all the return currents. I've divided this board up into several different sections. You can see here we have the STM32 microcontroller part right in the center. We have the USB connector and power on the right side. And then we have the headers, the GPIO headers here at the top and here at the bottom. A really useful feature in KiCad is if you click on View, 3D Viewer, you can actually see what your 3D render might look like. This is really useful for checking maybe component distances, seeing if text overlaps maybe holes and stuff like that. And it's really just good to see. So I would suggest always using that to see, to make sure your design looks all right. But let's go through section by section. So the first section over here is where this USB connector is and the power section. This is the LDO regulator, and you can see I've put the bypass and decoupling capacitors really close to the pins. So VCC in ground and 3.3 volts in ground, really close to each other. That's generally what you want to do with bypass and decoupling capacitors. You can see I've got the power on indicator LED and the current limiting resistor right next to it, but in theory you could put this anywhere on the board. It's just nice to put the indication right next to where the power is. You can also see, because we're only using a two-layer board, I've had to route the 3.3 volt power to the remaining of the board, and I've used really thick traces. So these are 0.75 millimeter traces, and this is to make sure we have a lower impedance when we route all this power to the remaining of the board. And you can see I've done that. I've routed maybe underneath some of the connectors, past the connectors to make sure I can reach all the points. But make sure you keep thick traces when you're routing power, and then narrow them down when you go into components. The next thing we can look at is the STM32 microcontroller. So again, let's look at the 3D view to make sure everything looks all right. And you can see all these small capacitors like C4, C6, C7, C5, and so on. These are decoupling capacitors, and I've tried to put them as close as possible to these power pins over here, 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 and so forth. You don't want to put them right next to them, because remember, you want to design for manufacturability and be able to have this board actually assembled. So for example, if you want to desolder one of these components, you don't want to put it too close. So you want to do your decoupling capacitors first and make sure they're nice and close to the relevant power pins. Most important stuff first, that includes decoupling capacitors, but that also includes the crystal oscillator. And you can see here, I've just routed that out to the crystal and made sure, again, the load capacitors are nice and close to this crystal. After I've routed the important stuff like crystals and decoupling capacitors, I can do stuff like the boot zero, select resistors, or this indicator LED over here. As you can see, I've used a couple of vias, and I've only used vias to essentially dig my way down into the ground plane, which is on layer 2. So if I click on layer 2, the bottom copper, and then over here to show filled areas, you can see actually the whole bottom layer is filled with copper. And you can do that by clicking this button over right, add filled zones, click somewhere, select the net, and then just draw an outline. And that's how I did this bottom layer. And you can see everything that needs to be grounded is connected to ground. And that's really good because every time I'm on the top layer, and every time I want to connect something to ground, I just do a short trace and then dig my way through using this via command over here. As you can see, I've tried to keep the vias not in the pad, but right next to the pad. So you want short, wide traces from the ground pads to the via straight into the ground plane. This makes sure you have a nice low impedance path. The rest of the routing is pretty simple. All I've done is connect all of the peripheral pins out to these GPIO headers, and that's about it. We also have these USB traces over here, which are a differential pair. And the way you route differential pairs in KiCad is click on route, differential pair, and then click on either D plus or D minus, and you can start routing. And remember, because we call them D plus and D minus, KiCad knows these are differential pairs and should be routed as such. Now, typically USB traces should have a characteristic impedance of about 90 ohms, but then again, we're running this at USB full speed, which is maximum of 12 megabits per second. And it really, really does not matter what trace impedance these are. These will work. I've also interestingly put the 1.5K pull-up resistor, remember which we needed on the D plus line, I've put that in the trace. So we don't have to make a little stub that goes up. And this is more useful for higher frequency designs, but I think it's nice to put in here as well. Once you're done with the routing, make sure to always perform this design rule check up here. And it'll tell you if some things are disconnected or we have unconnected or any problems, anything's too close and so on. But I don't have anything, so I can just close it. So everything looks fine. Once I've done that, I'll add my silk screen, for example, like a logo. I've just put like an STM32F breakout text here. You can do that with this button on the right side. Component designators, I've tried to put nice and neat where they should be. And of course, maybe some indicators of what the LEDs are. So a power LED, so why not indicate that? I've also indicated which pins on these connectors are power and ground, where there's plus and minus. You could, of course, write the silk screen next to every single pin and tell the user what it is, and that's probably a good practice. I've only done that for the back silk screen for the serial wire clock and serial wire debug IO pins. On the topic of silkscreen, you also want to indicate where the pin 1 locations are, all locations and orientations of diodes. So typically I would do that with a small dot next to pin 1, and you can use the add graphic circle tool to do that. For diodes, such as the LEDs, I will mark where, for example, the anode is with a plus. And this just helps the assembly process, or if you assemble it yourself, it'll just help you. Lastly, you can notice I've written JLC, 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 JLC. And this is because when I order my PCBs with JLCPCB.com, you can hide the serial number that they typically put on boards. And so it'll be hidden nice down to this chip. Remember, if we go to 3D view, the serial number will actually be printed underneath this chip and won't be seen on either layer, which is really nice. So once you're happy with your layout and routing, you've made sure that the schematic is correct, that the design rules check is correct, you can export your assembly and Gerber files. The way you do that is click File, Plot, Gerber, choose an output directory. The default layer settings are fine, and typically the default settings are fine as well. Click Generate File, Draw Files, and then click on Generate Draw File. Once you've done that, you can click Plot, and that'll generate all the Gerber files. Now we also need to generate the pick and place information if we want to get assembly, and the way you do that is go on File, Fabrication Outputs, and Footprint Position File. Typically, I would put it in CSV and in millimeters, and maybe a single file for the board. And then just click on Generate Position File, and you can then upload that to JLCPCB. I've already created the production files necessary for JLCPCB manufacturing and assembly. You just need to go to my GitHub repository, which is in the link in the description. So I have this Gerber folder where I've exported the zip file for which you need for production. And if you want to get assembly as well, there's this folder over here that contains a footprint position file as well as a bill of materials. The bill of materials you can export in KiCad, by clicking on this BOM icon up here and then choosing the relevant one. I just chose BOM CSV group by value and then adapted it to the JLC parameters. So let's order it with JLCPCB now. So here I am on jlcpcb.com, and let's go through the ordering process. So click on quote now, then upload the Gerber files, wait till that processes, and then we'll get a little Gerber preview. JLCPCB will fill in the layer count and dimensions for us. So you can use the Gerber viewer just to check that everything's in order. The dimensions have been filled in automatically. You can choose your PCB quantity. I typically go for lead-free, hot air surface leveling, or ENIG. Remove order number. Remember, we put the order number JLC, 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 JLC underneath the chip, so click on specify location. We also want assembly, so click on assembly. We would like the top part assembled, and let's say we want five of them, and we're just going to let the fiducials or tooling holes be added by JLCPCB. Next thing, we need the assembly data, so add a bill of materials, navigate to the folder, and also the footprint position files. Now there'll be this list on the left and right side where you have to compare that what you selected is actually what the automatic system recognized. So go through and have a little check, but I've already done that for you. Now you can review the parts placement, make sure the orientations are correct. But because we've put this stuff on the silkscreen, like pin 1 indicators or the positions of the anodes of the diodes, JLC will correct that for you if it doesn't look right. But you can see I've already done it for you and it's all ready to order. So we can 5 boards. Assembled all the SMD parts assembled for about $33, excluding shipping. So that's pretty good.